Now let me talk about the reception of carbon dioxide in mosquitoes. We published this work initially in BioArchive under the title CO2 per C activate carbon dioxide receptors. And later on, the paper was accepted and published early this year in Insect Biochemistry and Molecular Biology. So here are some of the highlights of the paper that I'm going to be discussing today. Xenopus oocytus co-expressing Culex GR1 and GR2 were insensitive to sodium bicarbonate. Culex CQGR2 plus CQGR3 gave robust dose-dependent response to sodium bicarbonate. CQGR1 seems to modulate the response of the binary receptor CQGR2, CQGR3. The activated receptor responded to aqueous carbon dioxide, not bicarbonate, and similar response profiles were observed to GR from other mosquito species. As we know, carbon dioxide is a very important attractant for mosquitoes. They are using traps since the early 1950s. And this one disadvantage is because they don't capture many grafted mosquitoes. We know that the mosquitoes respond to carbon dioxide, but the question is, do they respond to carbon dioxide itself, to bicarbonate, or to protons? When carbon dioxide penetrates the sensilla lymph, it reacts with water and generates an equilibrium between CO2 itself, protons, H+, and bicarbonate. In 2007, the group from John Carlson published this paper in PNAS where they show that in Drosophila, they use two GRs, GR21A and GR63A, to the reception of carbon dioxide. And then they ask the question whether these receptors are responding to CO2 itself, to bicarbonate, or to protons. Same year, using different approach, Les Vauchau's lab also published a paper in Nature where they show the two receptors from Drosophila again are necessary, GR21A and 63A. And they ask the same question, whether this response is to CO2 or to bicarbonate. 2015, Wei Zhu and Alisa Anderson, they published this paper where in Naturwissenschaft, where they show for the first time CO2 receptors from Lepidoptera. And again, they have the same question about the CO2 or bicarbonate is responding. And finally, very recently, Chen Zhu Wang, his group in China, published this paper in Insect Biochemistry and Molecular Biology, and they refuted the hypothesis that it was CO2. They claimed that it was bicarbonate. So I thought that we could address this question by using the Le Chatelier principle. If you have this receptor expressed in an aqueous system, such as the Xenopus oocytus recording system. And the Ping Shi tried to express these receptors from our mosquito, Culex mosquito, and I'm going to show you the story. And the idea is that if you have this receptor expressed in an aqueous system, you can use the Le Chatelier principle. Le Chatelier principle shows that by changing the shifting this equilibrium, for example, if you increase the concentration of protons by lowering the pH, this equilibrium is going to be shifted to the left to increase the concentration of CO2 and decrease the concentration of bicarbonate. So if you know that the concentration of one species or the other is increasing or decreasing, and you know the response of the receptor is increasing or decreasing, we can make a direct correlation. So first, Ping Shi tested these receptors, and before anything else, what we do is that we check the naked oocytes not expressing receptors, and we see here response to bicarbonate and the sodium chloride. This is important because the perfusion buffer contains sodium chloride. So when we add the sodium bicarbonate, we are going to add the concentration of sodium, and we have to make sure that this is not an artifact in the system. So here, sodium bicarbonate and sodium chloride are given the equal response, just changing the amount of sodium in the buffer, and it causes a change in the equilibrium there, and therefore a small response, a shift of the baseline, basically. Now, when we receptor the we express the receptor CQs UR1 and 2 and 3, there was no response whatsoever, as shown here in the red line. And same thing with GR1 and GR2, no response. However, when patient here expressed GR2 and 3, the response was very robust to sodium bicarbonate. Then we conduct a dose-dependent response with this receptor, and also we compare that with the receptors having GR2 and 3, and in addition to that, the GR1, as shown here in the green line. As you see here, as always, when add GR1, the response of the receptor decreases significantly. This GR1, when we clone that, we find five different variants. One that has the sequence identical to the sequence that deposits in the gene bank, in the vector base, we call that the wild type. And the other ones we call by the name of the mutation, the points that are, they differ, some of them with one single amino acid residue difference and one of them with two amino acid residue. Then we test this receptor containing the GR2 and 3 alone, and GR1, 2, and 3, but one, we use different variants. For example, in the green one, this is a combination of the three receptors compared to the two receptors in blue, and we see a much lower response to sodium bicarbonate. And all the other variants also gave it lower response than the combination of the two receptors alone. The only one that is not significantly lower is the one that has the two point mutations, this variant with the two point mutations. Regardless, all of them reduce the response of the receptor to bicarbonate. So we then concluded that this might work as a modulation of the signal. So the literature says that the combinations GR1 and 3, we found that GR2 and 3 is functional, and GR1 work as a modulator. Then we want now to test the hypothesis where the receptor is responding to CO2 or to bicarbonate or to protons. And first we develop a method to measure the concentration of CO2 in solution. We use this carbon dioxide ion selective electrode from Thermo, used to be for Orion, and measure the amount of CO2 in solution. This device was developed to measure the total amount of CO2. So you lower the pH and you basically we force all the CO2 to come out, and then we measure the concentration of CO2. We modified that, we made a closed system so that we could, without changing the pH, measure the concentration of CO2 in solution at that time. And use the various standards, and everything was done sealed and maintained the concentration without much loss. Concentration of CO2 in a solution of sodium bicarbonate can be measured, can be calculated directly by this formula here that comes from when I teach biochemistry, for example. I use this formula because the CO2 bicarbonate buffer is a very important buffer in our blood system. And we can calculate that based on the amount of the nominal concentration of sodium bicarbonate and the pH of the solution. We can calculate the amount of CO2 in that solution. That's the blue line that we have there. But using our electrode, we could measure the real concentration, the exact concentration of the CO2 in solution. And then we find this red line here, and you see that they show a very good correlation, but at the high concentration, it's better to use the measured concentration of CO2 because it's more accurate. Then we did an experiment to bubble CO2 directly. Now we don't want the sodium bicarbonate, and we bubble CO2 directly depend of for how long you bubble that, the pH is going to be lower or much lower than that, depend of the for the duration of the bubbling. We did the various duration of the bubbling, and then we measured the concentration of CO2 and the response of the oocytes. As you see here, for 7.7, 76.7, and so on, for the response of CO2 directly bubble. And also with the same oocyte, and we repeated this many times, we also measure the concentration by providing sodium bicarbonate and, as a negative control always, using sodium chloride. Then, having the concentration of CO2 measured, we could expose this oocyte to challenge with various concentrations of CO2, and it shows a very beautiful dose-dependence relationship. Then we addressed the first question, whether the protons, the pH, would be the response, like Carlson asking in 2007. For each of these preparations, you do the many of this preparation, I'm sure one of them here, we tested first the oocyte, and at the end we test the oocyte again to make sure that everything that was measured in between, it was with the oocyte still alive. So we tried the Ringer solution, we tried the sodium chloride, and sodium bicarbonate, both of them at 50 millimolar. Now we change the pH of the Ringer, and we have here, for example, pH 7, pH 6.5, pH 6, and pH 5.5. And you see basically there is no response for this change in pH. So it's not the pH itself that causes the receptor to fire. The receptor responds to something else. So now we exclude the protons from this picture, and now we address the question whether CO2 or bicarbonate. Again, using the Le Chatelier principle, we prepare a various solution. This was done in combination of myself and the Ping Shi. We prepared the aliquot solution. One part of the solution was subject to the oocyte, and another part, I lowered the pH and immediately subject to the oocyte. So we have various combinations of that, and I'm going to show you here at least three replicates now. You are going to see first the first sample without lowering the pH, and the second is the sample, the same sample, just by lowering the pH. And we know that the pH itself is not going to be respond. So here is what we get, a response, and then by lower the pH, a much stronger response, normal pH, lower pH, normal pH and the lower pH. We measure this pH later, and it show here on the top. So we did this experiment multiple times, and we find that with the initial pH, we have a response from the receptors, and when we lower the pH, the response becomes much higher. Here, for example, we have initially the pH was 7.73, and we lower the pH to, in average, 7.39, we got a much higher response on the oocytes. On the right side, I show also the response to the carbon dioxide, the concentration of the carbon dioxide in this solution. We have here about less than 20 ppm initially, and when we lower the pH, the amount of carbon dioxide goes above 30 ppm. Therefore, the receptor gives a larger response to that. If the response is larger because the concentration of CO2 is larger, then CO2 is the molecule that's activating the receptor. If it obeys the opposite, if the response will decrease, then we would conclude that bicarbonate is the activating entity. We also did the same set of experiments using the ternary mixture of the receptors, like we have GR2 and 3, and the added GR1. Of course, when we have the GR1 part of the picture, the response decreases, but nevertheless, when you lower the pH, we always see an increase in response. These are well, 18 times we did this experiment, and it's very clearly GR1 is not interfere with that process at all. So this is the pH initially, and the pH after we lower the pH to 6.78 in average. So we then concluded that CO2 per se activate carbon dioxide receptors, not bicarbonate. Then we asked the questions about Anopheles gambia, because these other species of mosquitoes also respond to CO2, and we want to compare. In case of Anopheles gambia, the receptors are named differently. These receptors are named A. gambia GR22, 23, and 24, which correspond to 1, 2, and 3. Because the genome of Anopheles was the original one, we keep that nomenclature, but for the genomes of Culex and the Aedes aegypti, these were sequenced later, so they use now the nomenclature 1, 2, and 3. So when I talk about GR1 in Culex, is equivalent to GR22 in Anopheles gambia. So we did the same experiment now, using the combination of equivalent of GR2 and 3, in that in case of gambia GR23 and 24, compared to GR1, 2, and 3 in case of Anopheles gambis GR22, 23, and 24. The top trace is the response to the binary, and the bottom trace is the response to the ternary receptor. So what we see here, that I already calculated here the difference of response, subtract the response of sodium itself. Let's say for 200 millimolar, the response was 840 nanoampere. If you look at the bottom trace, now we have that the response was 67.5. So decreases the response when we have the ternary receptor. For 300 millimolar, the response was 1030 nanoampere, and the response by the ternary receptors was 806. This is one example. We have many of those examples, and it's consistent that every time we get a lower response when GR 22 is also involved in the system. We did the same with Aedes aegypti. Aedes aegypti again has three receptors, and it has been claimed that the GR 1 and 3 was responding. We did the same experiment with Aedes aegypti. On the top trace, we have Aedes aegypti GR 2 and 3, and the bottom trace, we have GR 1, 2, and 3. Looking here, for example, 200 millimolar of sodium bicarbonate, we have 100 nanoampere, the difference of response, subtracting the response of sodium itself. And when we have the receptor with the three, GR1, 2, and 3, the response reduced to 54. Again, this is repeated with some other traces. So, in conclusion, for all these three types of mosquitoes, the CO2 per se is activating carbon dioxide receptors, and they are using GR2 and 3, with GR1 being a modulator. It was intriguing because in Drosophila they have only two GRs that are involved in detection of CO2, and it's very well known that GR21A and GR63A are the receptors involved in that detection. The group of Lestivaux shall knock out GR63A, and they show very unambiguously that without that receptor, there's no response to CO2. The GR21A was very important for us now, because we found this thing about GR1, that's the order log of GR21A, and it's a modulator in mosquitoes, and why this here is a receptor itself. So we wanted to knock out the GR21A, and for that we use CRISPR-Cas to knock out the Drosophila melanogaster GR21A. After knock out that, we use single cell recording. You know that in the antenna of the fly, the sensilla AB1 responds to this carbon dioxide. They have four neurons, and one of the neurons responds to carbon dioxide. However, the response is not very easy to see. You see here, the knockout, the red line, carbon dioxide response disappear, but it's hard to see because there are the natural spikes there. And on the bottom, we have the response of the flies, and there is a response to carbon dioxide. It's not very easy to see because it's a very crowded a neuron with four responses there. So it's not the easiest thing to see, the response of carbon dioxide. So I thought that we could do something different. We could develop a system to measure by EAG from the flies. I don't think anyone has done EAG for CO2 of flies, but we are able to generate, to create the equipment here and deliver CO2 at the various concentrations. For that, we use this device that allows us to measure the concentration of CO2 directly. For example, I can measure the concentration of CO2 right now as we speak. So instead of guessing what's the concentration of CO2 that you are subject to the mosquitoes or to the flies, we measure the concentration of CO2. As you see here, the stimulus delivered was connected directly to the CO2 detector, and the CO2 detector sends a signal that we measure here in the iPad. As you see here on the right, we have the first puff is always lost because the system is not in equilibrium yet, but the second one on, you see that the consistent response there. So we calibrated that, and we calibrated this. We can see, for example, that if you pick up a source of CO2 of 2%, remember that this 2% are not accurate because these are mixture that we make ourselves or we buy the gas from a company with a certain concentration. So the 2% is the dose, the source dose, and then when we deliver this dose to the fly, the concentration that arrives on the antenna is about 600 ppm. If you do a 5% dose in our case, then we have 1400 is the concentration that arrives on the antenna. So because now we are measured directly what the fly antenna is seeing at the time. And if you go to 10%, we have 3000 ppm. We did this at various different concentrations and very reproducible. So now we know the source, we know the concentration that the mosquitoes are seeing. Would it be better to do that at the same time as you puff the CO2 and record the response from this detector, from the CO2 detector? However, the presence of this detector closer to the EAG system generates too much noise. It was not possible to do that way. So we did separately. Now, we use the wild type flies and we measure the concentration of CO2, various concentration of CO2 in the EAG response. This trace here, the first trace, the black one, is the response of the blank. The last one, the black one too, is the response of 2E hexenal at 0.1%. And in between, different concentrations of CO2 start from 300, 600, and going up to 13,000 ppm. And you have a beautiful dose dependence response. And it's above 80,000, it's already saturating. You see, 80,000, 13,000, the response are basically the same. So we know that the fly respond to that, but we want to make sure that this is the case. So we pick up the flies, the knockout 638 that was generated by Les Vosges lab, and we tested that to show here that the flies are responding to E2 hexenal, but normally response to the blank, in this case here, almost no signal at all, and CO2, no difference from the blank. So this is to show that the response that we are showing here for carbon dioxide is indeed real because we have a very good system here to test the knockout fly. And without the CO2 receptor functional, there is no response whatsoever. However, when we did this experiment, so we used the W1118 wild-type flies for record the EAG, and when we do the CRISPR-Cas, the background was YW. So we repeated the same thing with YW and they respond in the same way. There's no difference. It was not expected to happen difference, but we want to be absolutely certain the control is the same. Then we move to the flies, the knockout, the 21A knockout, and with the heterozygous flies that's showing here on the left, we have response to E2 hexenal in red, response to the blank, keeps in blue, and the response to carbon dioxide, 900 ppm in this case here, very robust response. When we do the homozygous flies, no 21A now, the homozygous flies, the response to E2 hexenal in red, a very beautiful response there, response to the air blank, and CO2 has no difference. So we unambiguously show that it's this the 21A that in mosquitoes with the BGR1 one, and the modulator here is a receptor itself. Now we then ask the question, what if we pick up this receptor from the fly and put together with the receptors from the mosquitoes, the GR2 and the 3? So this is the last experiment that I want to show you today. And what we have in this experiment in here, we have GR2 and the 3 from Culex quinquefasciatus, and we add another sample compare GR2 and the 3 from Culex quinquefasciatus and the 21A from Drosophila melanogaster that you just saw. That's a very important receptor. If you knock out that receptor, there is no response whatsoever. So here, going from the left to the right, we have a combination. There's always a pair. The left one is plus GR21A, and the second one is without GR21A. In other words, the green is for the mosquito's receptors alone without a combination with the Drosophila receptor. So if you see, the response is always larger for the GR2 and the 3 for mosquitoes, but if you add GR21A from Drosophila melanogaster, the ternary receptor, then we have a much lower response. For example, 200 nanomolar solid bicarbonate, we have there a significant response, P is called 0.02, and if you go to 300 millimolar, it's even more clear the difference, the P is called 0.047. So, altogether, this result shows that number one, the receptors that are functional mosquitoes are 2 and 3. GR1 is a modulator. And if you add any other receptors to the GR2 and 3, like GR1 for mosquitoes or GR21 from Drosophila, the response is going to be smaller. I hope I conveyed the whole message to you. Thank you very much, and thank you to the National Institutes of Health, National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, for the funding of our research.